the higher education. Part of this is contained in Counsels to Teachers, pages 11 and on. Washington, D.C., May 7, 1909. To the teachers in Union College, dear fellow laborers, here are the words I spoke to you Monday morning, April 19, with a few paragraphs from a letter written upon the subject a few days before our visit to College View. We then, as workers together with him, beseech you also that you receive not the grace of God in vain. For he saith, I have heard thee in a time accepted, and in the day of salvation have I succored thee. Behold, now is the accepted time, behold, now is the day of salvation, giving no offense in anything, that the ministry be not blamed, but in all things approving ourselves as the ministers of God, in much patience, in afflictions, in necessities, in distresses, in stripes, in imprisonments, in tumults, in labors, in watchings, in fastings, by pureness, by knowledge, by long-suffering, by kindness, by the Holy Ghost, by love unfeigned, by the word of truth, by the power of God, by the armor of righteousness on the right hand and on the left, by honor and dishonor, by evil report and good report, as deceivers and yet true, as unknown and yet well known, as dying and behold we live, as chastened and not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing all things. Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion hath light with darkness, and what concord hath Christ with Belial, or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them, and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. There is constant danger among our people that those who engage in labor in our schools and sanitariums will entertain the idea that they must get in line with the world, study the things that the world studies, and become familiar with the things that the world becomes familiar with. This is one of the greatest mistakes that could be made. We shall make grave mistakes unless we give attention to the searching of the Word. The question is asked, what is higher education? There is no education higher than that contained in the principles laid down in the words that I have read to you from the 6th chapter of 2 Corinthians. Let our students study diligently to comprehend this. Through his own chosen messenger, God has given us light and instruction as to what constitutes the higher education. There is no higher education to be gained than that which was given to the early disciples and which is given to us through the Word. May the Holy Spirit of God impress your minds with the truth that there is nothing in all the world in the line of education that is so exalted as the instruction contained in the chapters to which I have referred. Let us advance just as far as the Word will take us. Let our righteousness be the sign of our understanding of the will of God committed to us through His messengers. It is the privilege of every believer to take the life of Christ and the teachings of Christ as his daily study. Christian education means the acceptance in sentiment and principle of the teachings of the Savior. It includes a daily conscientious walking in the footsteps of Christ, who consented to lay off his royal robe and crown and to come to our world in the form of humanity, that he might give to the human race a power that they could gain by no other means. What was that power? It was the power resulting from the human nature uniting with the divine, the power to take the teachings of Christ and follow them to the letter. In his resistance of evil and his labor for others, Christ was giving to men an example of the highest education that it is possible for anyone to reach. The Son of God was rejected by those whom he came to bless. He was taken by wicked hands and crucified. But after he had risen from the dead, he was with his disciples 40 days, and in this time he gave them much precious instruction. He laid down to his followers the principles underlying the higher education, and when he was about to leave them and go to his Father, his last words to them were, "I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." Christ will not forsake us. Strong temptations will come to many who place their children in our schools because they desire the youth to secure what the world regards as the most essential education. Who knows what the most essential education is unless it is the education to be obtained from the book which is the foundation of all true knowledge? Those who regard as essential the knowledge to be gained along the line of worldly education are making a great mistake, one which will cause them to be swayed by individual opinions that are human and erring. To those who feel that their children must have what the world calls the essential education, I would say, bring your children to the simplicity of the Word of God and they will be safe. We are going to be greatly scattered before long, and what we do must be done quickly. The light has been given me that tremendous pressure will be brought upon every Seventh-day Adventist with whom the world can get into close connection. We need to understand these things. Those who seek the education that the world esteems so highly are gradually led farther and farther from the principles of truth until they become educated worldlings. At what a price have they gained their education? They have parted with the Holy Spirit of God. They have chosen to accept what the world calls knowledge in the place of the truths which God has committed to men through his ministers and prophets and apostles. And there are some who, having secured this worldly education, think that they can introduce it into our schools. But let me tell you that you must not take what the world calls the higher education and bring it into our schools and sanitariums and churches. I speak to you definitely, this must not be done. Upon the mind of every student should be impressed the thought that education is a failure unless the understanding has learned to grasp the truths of divine revelation and unless the heart accepts the teachings of the gospel of Christ. The student who, in the place of the broad principles of the Word of God, will accept common ideas and will allow the time and attention to be absorbed in commonplace and trivial matters, will find his mind becoming dwarfed and enfeebled. He will lose the power of growth. The mind must be trained to comprehend the important truths that concern eternal life. I am instructed that we are to carry the minds of our students higher than it is now thought by man to be possible. Heart and mind are to be trained to preserve their purity by receiving daily supplies from the fountain of eternal truth. The divine mind and hand have preserved through the ages the record of creation in its purity. It is the Word of God alone that gives to us an authentic account of the creation of our world. This word is to be the chief study in our schools. Here we may hold converse with the patriarchs and prophets. Here we may learn what our redemption has cost one who was equal with the Father from the beginning and who sacrificed his life that a people might stand before him redeemed from every common earthly thing and renewed in the image of God. If we are to learn of Christ, we must pray as the apostles prayed when the Holy Spirit was poured upon them. We need a baptism of the Spirit of God. We are not safe for 1 hour while we are failing to render obedience to the Word of God. I do not say that there should be no study of the languages. The languages should be studied. Before long, there will be a positive necessity for many to leave their homes and work among those of other languages. And those who have some knowledge of foreign languages will thereby be able to communicate with those who know not the truth. Some of our people will learn the languages in the countries to which they are sent. This is the better way. And there is one who will stand by the side of the faithful worker to open the understanding and to give wisdom. If you do not know a word of the foreign languages, the Lord will make your work fruitful. as you go among these people and present to them the publications, the Lord will work upon their minds, giving them an understanding of the truth. Some who take up the work in foreign fields can teach the word through an interpreter. As a result of faithful effort, there will be a rich harvest gathered that you do not understand. There is another line of work to be carried forward, the work in the large cities. There should be companies of earnest laborers working in the cities. Men should study what needs to be done in the places that have been neglected. The Lord has been calling our attention to the neglected multitudes in the large cities, yet little regard has been given to the matter. We are not willing enough to trouble the Lord and to ask Him for the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and the Lord wants us to trouble Him in this matter. He wants us to press our petitions to the throne. The converting power of God needs to be felt in our ranks. The most valuable education that can be obtained will be found in going out with the message of truth to the places that are in darkness, just as the first disciples went out in obedience to the commission of Christ. The Savior gave the disciples their directions in a few words. He told them what they might expect. "I send you forth," He said, "as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves." These workers were to go forth as the representatives of Him who gave His life for the life of the world. The Lord wants us to come into harmony with His Spirit. If we will do this, His Spirit can rule our minds. If we have a true understanding of what constitutes the essential education and endeavor to teach its principles, Christ will stand by us to help us. He promised to His followers that when they should stand before councils and judges, they were to take no thought what they should speak. "I will instruct you," He said, "I will guide you." Knowing what it is to be taught of God when words of heavenly wisdom are brought to our mind, we will distinguish them from our own thoughts. We will understand them as the words of God, and we will see in them life and power for us. "I will give you tongue and utterance. Of all the precious assurances God has given me regarding my work, none has been more precious to me than this, that He would give me tongue and utterance wherever I should go. In places where there was the greatest opposition, every tongue was silenced. I have spoken the plain message to our own people and to the multitude, and my words have been accepted as coming from the Lord." If we look to Him, the Lord will help us to understand what constitutes true higher education. It is not to be gained by putting yourself through a long course of continuous study. In such a course, you will get some things that are valuable and many things that are not. The Lord would have us become laborers together with Him. He is our helper. He would have us come close to Him and learn of Him with all humility of mind. We are to educate the youth to exercise equally the mental and the physical powers. The healthful exercise of the whole being will give an education that is broad and comprehensive. We had stern work to do in Australia in educating parents and youth along these lines, but we persevered in our efforts until the lesson was learned that in order to have an education that was complete, the time of study must be divided between the gaining of book knowledge and the securing of a knowledge of practical work. Part of each day was spent in useful work, the students learning how to clear the land, how to cultivate the soil, and to build houses, in time that would otherwise have been spent in playing games and seeking amusement. And the Lord blessed the students who thus devoted their time to learning lessons of usefulness. Do not regard as most essential the theoretical part of your education. Medical students will have to follow the prescribed studies. They will listen to many theories that are contrary to truth. The Lord would have our medical students connect closely with those who believe and teach the truth, and as helpers with them, they can learn how to treat the sick and how to become faithful ministers to the sick. There are many ways by which the Lord would have us connect with those who honor and teach His word, and He will give us through this connection a most valuable education. You may say, "The world will not acknowledge us." What if the world will not acknowledge you? It is the power of God that makes the impression upon human mind. Let it be more and more deeply impressed upon every student that every one of us should have an intelligent understanding of how to treat the physical system. And there are many who would have greater intelligence in these matters if they would not confine themselves to years of study without a practical experience under the instruction of learned physicians and surgeons. The more fully you put yourself under the direction of God, the greater knowledge you will receive from God. As you keep yourself in connection with the source of all power, and as you minister to the sick, suggestions will come to your mind how you can apply to the case in hand the principles learned in your student days. Ye are laborers together with God. He is to be your chief instructor. Ellen G. White.